This podcast is brought to you by Free Buddhist Audio, the Dharma for your life. Our work is funded entirely by donations from our generous listeners. If you would like to help us keep this free, make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. Thank you and happy listening.
So I start off just saying a few general sort of remarks about in relation to the Buddha, only because I'm a bit worried that Buddhism won't make much of an appearance later on, so at least I'll mention a couple of Buddhist things to begin with. As probably most of you know, if you've been around here for any length of time, as far as possible, we try and have Buddhist festivals on a full moon. And this is a very traditional thing. It's said, and I don't really know the metaphysics of this, it's said that any practice you do on a full moon is a merit or a benefit for yourself and others is greatly multiplied. As I said, I don't really know the metaphysical reasons for this. One of them might be, or what was quite interesting when I was reading up on this a little bit, it seemed that it might come from the fact that, who knows which way around these things work, yeah? But it might have something to do with the fact that when you look at the Buddha's mythology, I don't know about biography, but his mythological biography, all the significant things in his life happened on the full moon. So he's born on the full moon. He goes forth from the palace on a full moon. He gets enlightened on a full moon. He makes his first teaching on a full moon. And he dies on a full moon. Yeah. This is according to the mythology. So there might be something connected with that. Obviously, they're sort of pragmatic. If you were in India 2,500 years ago, there's probably quite good pragmatic reasons why you might want to gather and practice together on a full moon. One of them being, of course, you would all know what day it was. You'd be able to tell what day it was. I was thinking, I presume in the, I don't know if it's true, right? I suspect in India at that time, I don't know, who knows, they probably had a lunar calendar. I think most older cultures actually had lunar calendars, so they would have a 28-day cycle. That's how the year was organized. Somewhere along the line, we changed that. Yeah. But there's also this idea that, of course, in the Western tradition, there's this idea of lunacy. So there's always been this idea that the moon has a very strong effect on the human being, and there's various explanations for this. Well, I shouldn't say explanations, there's various speculations on why this may be. But along with the idea of lunacy, there's also the idea that practicing on a full moon, if you are already quite developed, is the best time to get enlightened. And I was wondering about this because in a way the two are sort of connected perhaps, and the placidity or the fluidity or the malleability of the mind is stronger on a full moon. Somehow the moonlight, somehow the pull of the moon affects the mind in such a way that it can change. So you can go, and it's often said, well, I don't know about often said, but it's sometimes said that, that madness and enlightenment are not so far apart in a way. Yeah, both were kind of radical shift from a normal state of mind to a different state of mind. And both of them are a profound disruption. One in a very positive way, obviously, enlightenment. And one usually taken to be in a negative way. But both of them a profound disruption of the normal sense of self. Yeah. So maybe there's some connection there. Anyway, I've got a few poems. I thought I'd just, when I started, I think the reason why I thought All the Moon was because there's lots of poems of the moon. The moon features in lots of poems. So it's an image that has captured the human imagination throughout the whole of human history, really. I mean, I'm sure at some point or other, maybe regularly or maybe just now and then, it's captured your imagination, it's affected your imagination. And I think because the moon in lots of ways is very associated with the imagination, obviously it's a very popular image for poets. You know? We'll see how many we get through, I don't know. Anyway, we'll have a few poems about the moon, and I'll say a little bit about those poems. Normally when I use poetry and I talk about poetry, I'm not talking about what the poet might have meant. I am talking about what they might have meant, but I don't know what they might have meant, so I'm really just talking about my own feeling for the poem, what's attracted me to the poem, what's been the image for me. So maybe we'll start with David White, and so his Faith by David White. I've chosen ones that I've used before, actually, partly because they're ones that I have memorized. Also, I thought it'd be quite nice in a way for some of you that have heard these poems before, perhaps to hear them again, but also, you know, maybe hear a little bit of imagining around the poem. Anyway, this one's Faith. I want to write about faith, about the way the moon rises over cold snow, night after night. Faithful even as it fades from fullness, slowly becoming that last impossible sliver of light before the final darkness. But I have no faith myself. I refuse it the smallest entry. Let this then, my small poem, like a new moon, slender and barely open, be the first prayer that opens me to faith. I want to write about faith, about the way the moon rises over cold snow, night after night, faithful even as it fades from fullness, slowly becoming that last impossible sliver of light for the final darkness. But I have no faith myself. I refuse it the smallest entry. Let this then, my small poem, like a new moon, slender and barely open, be the first prayer that opens me to faith. I was on the bus coming in, and I was reciting it in my head, and I thought, my first reaction to that poem is one of tenderness somehow. And I think this is one aspect of the moon the imaginal moon, the response, the emotional response we can have to the moon. It was mentioned right at the beginning when I said about avalokiteshvara, really. That sort of tenderness, that's a sort of softness. You know, something that can be, not always, since the moon has many faces, but that can be something very tender, perhaps, about the moon. Then you get this image of it rising over cold snow, night after night, faithful even as it fades from fullness. And I suppose what's being this is a slightly obscure reference. I don't suppose. Well, I don't know. David White would be quite well read, but in alchemy, the white earth. There's this idea of the white earth. And the white earth is quite often associated, or it's used as a symbol for the psyche, the white earth. And it struck me that it's in a way, even in Buddhism, in a sense, this idea of whiteness or whitening, which I'll probably come back to this later, but this idea of whiteness is often used as a way of expressing consciousness, pure consciousness in a way. And of course it's just an image, but it's a very strong image of moonlight, this full moon over this white land, this white landscape. And I was thinking, well, it's a prayer inspired, you know, that there's some longing. So this is another aspect, I think, of the moon. It speaks to longing, speaks to our longing, and it speaks to our desire and longing, yeah. And so the moon inspires a longing for something, yeah? And in this case, it inspires a longing for faith. Yeah? I want to speak about faith. Why the moon rises over cold snow. And it's also, so it's in, and then the poem itself becomes a prayer. And I think this is quite an interesting idea, this idea of prayer and longing. Because in a way, a prayer to the moon in this case, prayer to Luna, the goddess of the moon, yeah? Prayer to the moon, and this idea of prayer is quite interesting because it seems to imply something coming into consciousness, some kind of longing for something arising into consciousness. And then the prayer itself is then a throwing out of that longing into the cosmos, as it were. And I was thinking from a practice point of view, this is quite an interesting thing to reflect on. Of course, this is the main motif of the moon, isn't it? It's a motif or an image of reflection. Yeah, it's an image of reflection. So everything we're talking about here, when we're talking about reflecting on it, is really under the power, under the rule of the moon. Yeah. Anyway, a prayer as something that comes into consciousness as an expression of some kind of longing. It's often a longing to belong, isn't it? And then that longing is cast out into the universe. It's cast either towards a god, sometimes towards a god, but it's put out of ourselves. So it's something that's not seized by the ego. something that's not appropriated by the ego, but it's a call to something bigger than us. Yeah, it's a call to something that cannot be held by a normal sense of self. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. We might have time to talk about it. You're right. Sorry. Do you want a drink of water or something?
Yeah, I think I can drink water.
I suppose obvious features in the poem is this idea of waxing and waning, the moon going from fullness to no moon at all. So this again, I think, is quite an interesting image for us, you know. And I think it goes back to a time when our lives were more in the rhythm of the world and in rhythm, more connected with nature. And I think one of the things that's happened when we've gone from this sort of natural rhythms, this natural sense of time, to a very mechanical sense of time. We've now got this sort of time that's regulated. Not only time, but our lives are totally kind of regulated and demarked, you know, by precise time. Where in the past, I think our bodies, which follow these circadian rhythms, these rhythms which are mirrored in echo, particularly in the woman, of course, echoed by this 28-day cycle, perhaps in all of us, we felt this much stronger connection with the cosmos and with nature, and we increasingly feel, I think, out of touch with this, and we are increasingly expected to be constant. So the moon kind of reminds us as an image that it's not constant. Every day is different. When it rises, it's different, slightly different from the day before. And of course, every day we get up, we're slightly different from the day before. But unfortunately for many of us, it's 5 days a week or another, we're expected to be exactly the same. You know, we're expected to be the same. We're not expected anymore to be sensitive or in train with the world in this way. And of course, living in the city and having central heated houses and having electric light, we become more and more disassociated with the natural world. And it, obviously there's advantages to the way we live, but I think one of the great disadvantages is to stop appreciating that just like the moon, we have phases. We have a natural rhythm, and that needs to be respected in a way, needs to be taken as far as we can. We need to take it into, and we don't need, it's not natural for us to be fully on 24/7, as they say these days. It's not natural for us to be this way. It's natural for us to have times when we're full, if you like, and times when perhaps we hardly shine at all. You know, we go into a more or less nocturnal, hibernate. You know, we go into these times when our lives are dominated by darkness, you know. And this, these days, of course, tends to get pathologized as there's something wrong with us. There's something wrong with us that we can't perform in an optimum fashion every day. But I don't think there is anything wrong with us. I think there's something wrong with us if we can perform in an optimum fashion every day. You know? There's something that we're fundamentally out of touch with. We're fundamentally out of touch with our own tide, which of course, you know, the tide of course is influenced by the moon, by the gravitational pull of the moon. White. There's a lot more. Maybe we'll come back to white. I don't know. We'll see. So this is another. This is a poem I use quite often. This is well, I do the poem. His name will come to me when I finish the poem. So this is let the day grow on you upwards through your feet, those vegetal knuckles, till your knees are stone. For by evening you are a black tree. And with evening let the swift thicken your hair, and the full moon rise from your forehead. And the moonlit veins of silver run from your armpits like rivulets under dry leaves. Full moon rise from your forehead, and the moonlit veins of silver run like rivulets under dry leaves. Sleep as ants cross your eyelids. You have never possessed anything as deeply as this. This is all you have ever owned. And the first outcry through forever. You can never be dispossessed. There's a black, who is he? A black poet.
David
Walcott, yeah, thank you. That black poem, and I suspect the poem's written, you know, about the black experience. Of slavery is comes from the Caribbean islands, but there was something, when I was thinking about that poem, there was something very interesting in it for me. It's a completely different association. It's connected to something I've already been talking about. But it was, it might just be a coincidence, but it was very reminiscent of me, for me, of alchemical ideas. And in particular, you have a blackening, a greedo. So in alchemy, which is a transformation, it's usually understood as a transformation of base metals such as lead to gold. Although many writers these days, in a way, not exclusively, but rather following Carl Jung, who in his later years, Jung started to look at alchemical texts. Evidently, it's quite an interesting story, he just had this book on alchemy, and most books on alchemy are full of very bizarre illustrations. Yeah, and a lot of, they weren't just words, they weren't just texts, the texts are usually fairly are very difficult to make any sort of logical sense of, and they're also full of lots of illustrations. Jung had this book evidently in his study for a long time, and when he first looked at it, he just thought, this is nonsense, I can't imagine. But he was kept getting drawn back to it, and in the end, he dedicated a lot of time and wrote a lot about alchemy. And I think it's true to say, by the end of his life, the alchemical metaphor had become probably the main metaphor that he was using to talk about his work and what he understood as the formation of the true self. And in alchemy, although it varies from alchemist, no two alchemists are the same, so this is quite interesting in itself. Although it varies hugely, there are some quite identifiable stages. And the first one is you get the primer materia, you get whatever it is that needs you want to transform. And this varies hugely, but it is usually something related to purity. Sometimes it says lead. Sometimes it's sort of urine of a virgin boy, or it's all sorts of weird stuff, yeah. But you get whatever it is, the material you're going to work with. So Jung got increasingly believed that actually most of this alchemy was actually not describing a physical process at all. It was actually describing a psychological movement. Yeah. Although the two might not have been in the alchemist's mind separate, because they functioned under the idea of sort of hermeneutic idea that to do something on one level had an effect on another level. So for them it was not necessarily absurd or contradictory that working actually on the transformation of metal would also work on the transformation of the alchemist's mind. But there's an interesting relationship here. The metal, all planets, according to alchemy, are related to a particular metal. And the metal grows, from the alchemist view, grows from seeds in the ground. And the metal related to the moon, unsurprisingly, is silver. Yeah. So silver is the metal which is... Related is the wrong word. In a way, the moon and silver, alchemical way of looking at things, is the same thing. Yeah. So it doesn't mean it's literally the same thing. But on an imaginal level, it's the same thing. Well, there's an energy between the moon and silver. In a way, you could say the moon brings forth silver, alchemically speaking. But anyway, in alchemy, the first stage is the negrito, or the blackening. So in the poem, we've got this, by evening you are a black tree. So this is brought about in alchemy by various very complicated and repetitive operations on the material, usually involved with heating and fixating and vaporizing. There's loads of different processes that usually have to be repeated maybe hundreds of times. This is quite an interesting image for me, that these things have to be repeated and repeated. And of course, as meditators, we're all we're all very familiar with this alchemical idea that we just sit and we just do the same thing. I've been doing the mindfulness of breathing for over 30 years, you know. You sit there, you just repeat it and you repeat it. You just keep going for it. This is the alchemical way, it's repetition. But anyway, the first movement is the breaking down of this primer material, the blackening of it, sometimes called the putrefaction. And the idea is that it has to be reduced to its elemental state. It has to be, the things in alchemy, look, again, this is quite interesting to me. For, alchemically speaking, for things to conjoin, they have to first be separated. So it's a kind of reduction, and it's a reduction to a state of chaos. And psychologically, as the colour suggests, it's black. It's again related to this idea I was saying before, that we have these natural movements of consciousness, or movements of mind. And one of the natural movements of mind is towards melancholy or depression, or what we now call depression, you know. And this reduction seems to be this kind of blackening. So it's the bringing up or the bringing into awareness of shadow material, we could say. And then the next process that happens is the whitening. And the whitening is under the auspices of the moon. And in this sense, as in lots of traditions, the moon is anima, it's the feminine. So it's bringing in the feminine element. It's bringing the unconscious more into consciousness. And this image is related to the silvering. The silvering, again, as I say, this is the metal associated with the moon. But it's also, of course, the metal associated with reflection. So mirrors, for example, silver. The silvering gives the mind its reflective quality, its ability to reflect. And it's this bringing in this material, this dark material is brought into consciousness and then reflected on. It's held in the light of the moon. But this light of the moon is a different kind of light than the light of the sun. Yeah? So the sun is associated with gold. We won't necessarily get on to gold, but before gold, alchemically speaking, you must have silver. The gold comes out of silver, alchemically speaking. Before you can have the gold, before you can have the sort of solar consciousness, and this is the sort of consciousness we quite often associate with, well, I suppose with things like enlightenment or, profound, well, I don't know, which sort of, anyway, you have to first have the silver in, the silver in mind. So this is the ability to begin to reflect through the imaginal faculty rather than the rational faculty. So gold and is quite often associated with the sort of masculine, rational faculty, where silver is associated with the imaginal, feminine. And this is the ability to allow things to have their own image not to bring them under the control of the rational mind, but the ability to be with the irrational material, but not in a but in a reflective way. Yeah. In the Greek tradition, in the ancient, at least in some, I say in the Greek typical, it was a very diverse tradition, the Greek, but I think it was generally held that when you died, initially the soul went to the dark side of the moon, it went to the other side of the moon, and it was here where the soul went back there for reflection. And if a soul became re-embodied without spending the appropriate amount of time the other side of the moon, you got typhoon, you got distorted, you got malformed animals or humans. Yeah? So the soul, if it took a body again too soon, without going through this period of reflective purification that occurred the other side of the moon, you got deformity. Yeah? Not necessarily perhaps physical deformity, but psychological deformity. So again, but anyway, so in the alchemical, this stage of whitening, which is a rejoining of the feminine, or a conjunction of the feminine and masculine, which is a prerequisite to the libido that comes later, the readiness, just part of the process, but it's a completely necessary process. And what it implies, to some extent, is that a type of lunacy is necessary. Yeah, a type of lunacy is necessary. A type a period where the imagination becomes liberated. It becomes liberated, in a way it becomes liberated from the ego. There's a separation. So it's no longer under the control of the ego, but it becomes multiplicitous, it multiplies. In this way of thinking, the nature of the psyche is not to become unified in the sense of monolithic or single, but to become increasingly multiplied, increasingly variegated. Yeah? And so within the whiteness, all colours potentially held, yeah? Within this whiteness. Anyway, there's much more one could, we could talk, say about alchemy, but the thing about alchemy is really, it's just a way of inviting the imagination. So if you ever get involved with that through Jung or other people, you will find it impossible to really pin down or understand. But what you will find is that it's rich with image. And one of the images often used is the image of the moon, and this image of whitening, because we've had this in the first poem of the snow, this image of whitening. Well, it's a kind of purification, but it's a kind of a mind which is capable of holding everything, holding multiplicity. So it's not a reduction in this sense. No. But it's a movement from a factual or believing that the external world is a factual world, to understanding that the external world is also dependent upon the imaginal. So So it's a really, it's an extension of the imagination into the world. Probably one of the reasons that moonlight or full moon or the moon is so evocative is that it somehow allows this to happen a bit more. It happens. If you ever go for a walk in the woods or a walk in the moonlight, your imagination is much more alive than if you go perhaps in bright sunshine. Yeah. There's pleasure in them both, but your imagination comes alive under the influence, under the light of the moon. I remember once going to see, this is just an aside really, I was living in San Francisco and I went to the Castro to see Night of the Hunters. You've heard that film, Night of the Hunters, which I've seen before in one of my favourite films. I love that film, and it's Robert Mitchum, isn't it? And he's this really demonic creature. He's after these two kids. It's also got an old... anyway, I won't go there. Anyway, with love and hate on his... tattooed on his fist. Anyway, it's got this scene where these kids are trying to get away from this sort of demonic figure of Robert Mitchum who's after them. And they're on this raft going down the river. And there's this great full moon hanging in the sky. And they're going down there and there's all these little animals and things going on. Anyway, it's very weird. Very surreal, weird. Lawton, wasn't it? It was the only film that Lawton ever directed, I think. And it's a very weird film. If you've never seen it, you get a chance to go and see it. But one thing about it, you have to sort of take it seriously. And I don't know if any of you've been to San Francisco, the Castro. Anyway, the Castro is a lovely Art Deco cinema. But for some reason, the audience at the Castro just found it totally, it is a bit sort of camp in a way, but anyway, found it totally hysterical, and I was really quite upset. I said, no, you've got to take it seriously, it was a very serious film, anyway. I digress. Maybe we'll leave. So we got a poem there with a kind of black and then white, and then some sort of resolution, and then I suppose the resolution is just the sense of belonging, the sense of belonging in the world, and what you possess is just life. You know? This is really all you've ever possessed. You know, you're kind of naturally born into being part of life. Part of life. Yeah. Anyway. This is Hasif. This is admit something. Admit something. Everyone you say to them, love me. Everyone you see, you say to them, love me. Of course, you don't say this out loud, or else someone would call a cop. Still though, consider this great pull in us to connect. Why not be the one who lives with a full moon in both eyes? And he says in that sweet moon language, what every other eye in this world is dying to hear. Why not be the one that lives with a full moon in both eyes? And says in that sweet moon language, what every other eye in this world is dying to hear. We start to get a sense of how versatile the moon is, really, and because here the moon, often associated with love, as it was with avarice, etc., it's often associated with passion and love, and in this case a kind of real tenderness and againness, this motif of longing, yeah, this motif of longing, the moon representing the longing. And of course this basic longing for us to be part of, you know. And of course very, very beautiful in a poem, this great pull in us to connect, because in a way this is mirrors the relationship of the actual planetary relationship between the Earth and the Moon. The Moon is always falling towards the Earth, but because of its elliptical movement, it stays in orbit. Yeah, but there's this pull between these two bodies. And of course, at one time, the moon was part of the Earth. You know, and it got separated, and there's still this longing between the moon and the Earth. And I was thinking about, this has been a bit of a theme in my psyche for a while now, this idea of the positive nature of desire. Now obviously I mean desire in a particular way. Desire quite often gets quite a bad rap in Buddhism, I think. I'm talking about desire in a particular sense, and perhaps in a bit of a sense that was invoked in the first poem, really, a desire to somehow open up to something bigger than yourself. This is what we get sometimes, don't we, when we look at the moon or we look at the night sky, some sort of sense of expansion, a wanting to open to the cosmos. Cosmos, interesting enough, Hillman said about the word cosmos, it's got a closer relationship to the word cosmetic. It's very close to the word cosmetic, which originally meant was related, well, still is related to beauty, you know. The way things present themselves beautifully. And I think one of the ways we can understand this desire is a desire for beauty, a wish to open up to beauty. And not in the cosmetic sense of the common use of that word now, but in the sense of things are beautiful when they reveal themselves fully. So again, a connection to the moon, really. The moon is beautiful in all its phases, but perhaps it particularly has a particular pull or particular sort of gravitational pull to our hearts or our love or whatever. The tides in us when it's full, when it reveals itself fully. Anyway, this idea of as a relationship, interesting enough, between the moon and the throat chakra as well, partly through the colour white, but other associations as well, but the movement from need, a feeling of need, I think this is what this poem is talking about, really, that most of us, most of the time, are in a state of, I mean, more or less, having a sense of need that we want we need love, or we need connection, we need things, and we experience this need as a emptiness. Yeah, we experience it as an emptiness, there's something missing in us. And I think what I mean, there's a possible progression to a desire which is experienced. We talk about being full of desire, don't we? When we have desire, we're somehow full, psychically rich. Yeah. When we have need, we're psychically empty and poor. So there's a need, there's a movement from need to desire. And the poem suggests that movement is achieved through fully acknowledging the need. So why not be the one that lives with a full moon in both eyes? So it's like you stop. Instead of not saying it out loud, you wear it fully. Yeah? Your need is fully expressed, and by being fully expressed, it becomes, which means to speak it. We start to speak its name. Yeah? We start to speak its name, and by speaking its name, it gets some again kind of alchemical process. No doubt under the ruling influence of the moon, some process happens in which it gets transformed into desire. And then desire is this very, in the positive sense, gives us energy and allows us to act in the world. Well, when it's this need, it just cripples us. Yeah? It doesn't give us energy or passion or allow us to act creatively in the world. So when we have a desire, in a sense I mean it, we find a way of expressing in a creative way, yeah? Either in communication or through the arts or through our work or through our family relation, we find a way of expressing this need becomes this way in which we become fulfilled and we help fulfill or we help others. Yeah. Anyway. Okay. And this again, this image of reflecting, because this is only possible insofar as we're able to reflect, or we're able to start to hold. We're able to acknowledge and begin to hold these things in awareness. Yeah. So this transformation is only possible with the reflective nature of the mind. Yeah? So we're again in some alchemical reflective silvering of the mind needs to take place. Yeah? Some kind of silvering of the mind needs to take place. Okay, we'll have one last. We'll have one last one. I don't know. Maybe I won't say anything about this. But this poem's got a particular kind of resonance to me, partly because I spent 8 years in San Francisco, and I did a lot of retreats when we were out there, and we nearly always did the retreats in the same place. We didn't have our own retreat centre, so we used to hire this Zen centre up in the Santa Cruz Mountains. The Santa Cruz Mountains are just above Palo Alto. They're called mountains, but they're just sort of big hills, really. But they're very, very beautiful hills, and you've got the Pacific Ocean not far away. And you just go to this place called Jikoji, and it was a Zen retreat center, a very beautiful traditional Zendo, which was on a very steep hill that was built. One side was probably nearly as high as this ceiling off the earth on piles, with a veranda all the way around. Anyway, it was in a valley. What you get there a lot is you get the mist coming in, the sea mist comes in, and we used to have this tradition of walking. If there was a strong moon, particularly if there was a full moon, we'd go up the hill. Listen to me, we'd go up to this ridge that overlooked the ocean. The ocean was quite a long way away. With the moon, just the moon there, and the mist used to come in, and it used to fill up all the valley bits, and the tops of the hills would just be sticking out of the mist, and they just looked like islands in this sea of mist. And it was one of the most sublime things I've ever seen. It was absolutely beautiful. And anyway, this is a Ryokan poem, so aim of a Buddhist poem. Doesn't have a name in it. The night is fresh and cool. Staff in hand, I walk through the gate. Wisteria and ivy grow together along the winding mountain path. Birds sing quietly in their nests. A monkey howls nearby. Reaching a tall peak, the village appears in the distance. The old pine are full of poems. I bend down for a drink of pure spring water. There is a gentle breeze. A moon hangs overhead. By a deserted building, I pretend to be a crane floating among clouds. Ryokan was a hermit, and I think of him as an old man up on this ridge, on his own, with the moon above him, just imitating this crane, you know, just imitating this bird. It's a lovely sort of image, you know. And I suppose that's the last thing, perhaps the last quality of the moon. It's also got a kind of, well, it's a kind of lunacy, isn't it? It's quite lunacy there in a way. So it's sort of playfulness even, perhaps, you know, a joy even, a particular type of a joy. Why that poem came to mind, just to say this, there's lots of legends about, in a lot of Eastern countries, there's also a Buddhist thing, lots of these Eastern countries, they don't have a man in the moon. They have a rabbit in the moon. I say if you look at the moon, you can see a rabbit. And there's various stories in some Chinese traditions. It's a rabbit with a pestle and mortar, and he's making the elixir for the immortals. So an alchemical image is quite interesting. But in one of the stories, there's this rabbit who wants to ride the moon, and he persuades somehow this crane to take him to the moon. And the rabbit, quite a big rabbit, quite a fat rabbit, and he holds on to the legs of a crane as the crane flies into the moon. And so heavy that he stretches the legs longer and longer and longer. And this is why the crane has long legs. It's like in the Jataka story, the story of a rabbit. A monkey, an otter, a jackal, and a rabbit joke. That's not a joke. There's the four animals, and they decide to practice generosity. And they come across this old man, and the monkey goes and gets him some fruit and peels and gives him this fruit. And then I think the otter. I can't remember. I suppose the otter gets him a fish. And the jackal gets him steals a lizard from somewhere. No, that's seen as, you know, not very nice. Jackal's got a bad rap. And the rabbit thinks to himself, well, I can't give him, all I eat is grass. I can't give him grass. So he throws him, this old man built this fire. And so the rabbit throws himself in the fire. And of course, he gets that, he's not burnt by this fire. And of course, the old man turns out to be a god, the king of the gods. And he gets the rabbit out and he makes the image of a rabbit on the moon to celebrate his altruism. Anyway. So anyway, maybe I'll leave it there.
We hope you enjoyed this week's podcast. Please help us keep this free. Make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. And thank you.